vamos a hacerlo más académico, vamos comenzando. Entonces, bienvenidos a la Universidad Autónoma Metropolitana para el Día de la Cosmonáutica, dentro de la Semana de la Cosmonáutica en México, es el Día de la Cosmonáutica en la UAM, la Universidad Autónoma Metropolitana. Tenemos en la mesa, como nuestros invitados principales, a Blanca Rebollar, de la Agencia Espacial Mexicana. Tenemos también al profesor Joaquín Delgado, del Departamento de Matemáticas. Al profesor Otón Gandarilla, del Departamento de Ingeniería Eléctrica. Al profesor Tuishev Yajeslav Genadevich, Alexander Monosov, de Moscú, y es investigador también en la Agencia Nacional de Aeronáutica y el Espacio, NASA, de los Estados Unidos, y al cosmonauta ruso Alexander Misurkin, de la Agencia Roscosmos de la Federación Rusa, y que el año pasado estuvo en la Estación Espacial Internacional en una de las misiones más recientes, de la cual ya nos estarán platicando. Pues comenzamos con el profesor Joaquín Delgado. Gracias.
Okay, so let me make a brief introduction in English for our guests. We all didn't know what's the topic, so I will talk very, very smooth mathematics with a lot of pictures, and I will take as model a reference that will be at the end of the slides. So it will be a little bit of mathematics, but a lot of pictures. And the main idea is to give you an overview on how mathematics is involved in the mission design. So now I will speak in English, but my slides are in Spanish. So it will be in close connection. Okay, so. What's the main ingredient in this talk? I will talk to you on the what is called the restricted three-body problem, which is a problem of three bodies, one with a very small mass, and two massive bodies, which could be the Sun, the Earth, or maybe the Jupiter, and some moon, and a spacecraft. So, I will talk especially on how the model is built and some of special solutions that are used as bus stops to design further paths to design the space mission. So the main ingredient is the three bodies which are here. These are the two massive bodies, and they are rotating on a circular orbit. So we switch to a rotating frame where they are fixed, and we have the what is called the restricted three-body problem in a rotating frame. In that rotating frame, we have in fact three coordinates, the three special coordinates, and we will suppose that they are. The two main bodies are fixed in this reference frame, and the main task is to describe the motion of the spacecraft under the gravitational attraction of these two bodies. Okay, so these are the equations of motion. You would see that it is a very complicated system of differential equations. If you write down this system, you have a phase space of dimension 6. So it's a very complicated even to make a numerical computation, because you can just explore all the phase space, but you have to explore special orbits in a very clever way. So this is the model which is used to design find special orbits. And there is some, as in the problem of N-bound is there is a potential, and this potential gives you a first insight on where a spacecraft can be located. For example, for some value of the energy, you can have a spacecraft located around one of the primaries, maybe on the other, or maybe you can go farther away and go around to the two bodies. There's a lot of possibilities. For example, if you have some energy, then you can go from one primary to the other, and maybe you can go from the Earth to the Moon. So this is the first step towards understanding what's the global dynamics of this problem. There are special solutions which are called center configurations, relative equilibria, and these are solutions that in the rotating frame remain fixed for all time. These are called relative equilibrium because if you see them in the inertial frame, they will be periodic orbits in fact. Some solutions are analytical configurations of some known orbits in the two-body problems, like Keplerian orbits, circular orbits, elliptical orbits, etc. These are the main solutions that are known since Lagrange and Euler, and in the restricted three-body problem in the plane. These are called collinear configurations. Remember that we are in a rotating frame, so these primaries remain fixed. And if you put a spacecraft on each of these points, then it will remain fixed for all time. Also, you have a special configuration which makes an equilateral triangle. If you put a spacecraft in, it will remain all the time. But there are some differences between the collinear configurations and the Lagrangian configurations. For example, for small ratio of the masses, these equilateral configurations are stable. But this usually, for all values, these configurations for all values of the masses are unstable. So you need control if you want to keep a spacecraft maybe here to watch to the sun and look at the inner structure of the sun. Or maybe here if you want to put a spacecraft on the dark side of the moon. So these are special solutions which also exists in three-dimensional space. This is configuration space. These are positions in the rotating frame. And there is another direction. Let's call it the Z direction, which comes out to from the plane. Okay. So how do you see these kind of solutions in a rotating frame? They look like this. But in an inertial frame, they look like periodic orbits. They form an equilateral triangle, which preserves its form for all time. How about the collinear configurations? The collinear configurations also in the inertial frame are rotating circular orbits. You can make some elementary linear analysis and then linearize those equations. You can find a linear approximation, and then from this you can obtain some numbers which are called the eigenvalues of the linearization around the critical points. And these are the eigenvalues for the linear configurations. What these numbers say, these numbers come in pairs. These are complex conjugate eigenvalues, which says that at the linear level, you have very small periodic orbits. The period depends on the number, which is the imaginary part of this number. But there is also these real numbers. One is positive, one is negative, which says that the linear configurations are linearly unstable. So this will this shows that you will need control, as I said before, to keep a spacecraft in this kind of positions. in these linear configurations, you can take the initial conditions.
Around these linear configurations, you have you can take initial conditions, so you don't have any component along the unstable directions, and you have only solutions which are moving periodically or quasi periodically. This is a kind of solution in the linear level, and you have some you have two frequencies lambda, which are those numbers that I showed you before, and there's another number nu in three-dimensional case. But if you only if you have some special matching between lambda and nu, you will have a periodic orbit. In general, you will have some kind of Lissajous figure, like in this picture. These are simply projections of an infinitesimally linear orbit. But if you find a correct matching, then you can have a periodic orbit. And this orbit is called a halo orbit. This is a special orbit that has been used very systematically in order to design space missions. And in the case of resonance, then you can have those projections are, in fact, the projection of a closed curve in phase space. This is a real periodic orbit. Okay, so this is how the halo orbit is looks like in configuration space, in three-dimensional space. And these are the projections. And then, for example, here you can see in red a special solution that goes from the, let's say, from the Earth, and then goes and is situated in this halo orbit. It does some tasks there, and then it goes back along a very complicated return path. And that's the point that I want to tell you. In mission design, it's not true that the best path to go from one place to another is a straight line. You have to use the dynamics of the problem in order to use the less fuel you have in your spacecraft. Okay, this is the linear eigenvalues for the equilateral configurations for some spatial value of the masses. We say that they are linearly stable. I won't talk about that. But this is the main work to do. You have some special orbit. You have your spacecraft in some special orbit, and you want to situate it in some other special orbit to do the observations. And then what you do is to apply for a very small time a thrust in your spacecraft. This amounts to a change of the velocity, and then you go to some other place, and then for some number of changes in the velocity, these are the controls that takes you from one orbit to the other. And then the point is to design your orbit in order to minimize the overall fuel combustion. This is the old way to design orbits, which is to use Keplerian orbits. For example, you have here a circular orbit around the Earth. Then you make a subit change in the velocities, and then use a transfer elliptic orbit to go around to some orbit, maybe around the moon. That's the way that some mission designs like Voyager and other Galileo missions were designed. Here you see what people is doing right now. They are now using the special orbits like bus stations, and these tubes are represent special transfer orbits that go from one place to another. And here you see a simulation of one kind of orbit that goes from the Earth to the moon orbit. These are some missions that were successful in order to and were designed using this kind of solution of the restricted free body problem. The ICEE, International Southern Earth Explorer, it was a very complicated mission because the spacecraft was located in the halo orbit. Then it went to observe the tail of the magnetic field of the Earth, and then it went out to observe some of the comets in the outer space. The SOHO mission is the Solar Heliospheric Observatory, and the first researchers that use dynamics to design this kind of halo orbits were from the School of Barcelona. And the names of Carles Simon, Jaume Gimple, Gerard Gomez are very involved in this kind of research. This is again the halo orbit that we're using the Genesis mission. This was the first, as far as I know, the first mission that captured some material from the outer space, mainly from solar wind, and then came back to the Earth. It was the first time that we get outer space material after the Apollo missions in 1972. This is a very interesting problem that was solved using a new approach, which was proposed by Edward Le Brumeau and Miller. And the history is a sad one. The Muses mission used two spacecraft, two satellites. One was supposed to go around the moon, and the other was supposed to go around the Earth, and they will communicate between them. But there was enough fuel. One of them was lost, simply was lost. The other hadn't enough fuel to come back. So it was Belbruno and Miller designed a very bizarre solution that went a very long time, very far apart from the initial orbit, and came back. So now he has his special company, and maybe he's millionaire with this kind of story. Well, the recent research uses what is called the invariant manifolds associated to these spatial orbits. Invariant manifolds are surfaces which are composed of solutions. So since in ordinary differential solutions cannot cross in an ODE, then this defines invariant surfaces that cannot cross for another solution. Then you have this kind of tubes that if you understand the intersection of these tubes, then you can design different spatial missions. For example, these tubes, which are associated to orbits, can intersect, and it can mark out a path to go, for example, from one L1 point to another L2 point. But what is more interesting, we have some local approximations of spacecraft and two bodies, but maybe in another location of space, the main bodies are different. For example, in the first stage, maybe these are the moon and the Earth, but in some other stage, these are Jupiter and some of the moons of Jupiter. So you have different kinds of collinear relative equilibrium. Each of them have solutions, periodic solutions around them, and they have these tubes that can be connected in a very complicated way. So they can be used in order to design a very complicated path using the less fuel you can, because the fuel is really the dynamics which is involved in the problem. These are some projects that people are thinking to explore the moons of Jupiter. And just want to give the credits to this web page by Shane Ross. In fact, these authors were very involved in this last stream ideas
for mission design. Thank you.